Golly. Got you, big boy. Yes.
Simon & Schuster Audio presents Caught Me a Biggin, and Then I Let Him Go. Jimmy Houston's Bass Fishing Tips and Tales by Jimmy Houston with Stephen D. Price. Read by Jimmy Houston.
I don't get excited when I catch a fish or nothing. I don't know the difference between north and south, don't know the difference between up and down. But I know it when a big baby grabs my bait. Woo! Mercy.
Putting this audio program together wasn't very much different from putting together one of our Jimmy Houston Outdoors TV shows. We go out on the lake, grab a fishing rod, and chuck and wine, all the while talking about what we're doing and anything else that comes to mind. It just involved a tape recorder instead of a TV camera, and when the sessions took place on my ranger boat out on Otter Creek, I got to do two of my favorite things, fish and talk about fishing. This also gave me the chance to do something else I enjoy doing, tell stories. And I've included some of my favorites here, and most of them are even true. Now, this program isn't exactly a textbook. Yes, you'll pick up a mess of tips about equipment, methods, and strategies, and how and why they work, but hopefully you'll laugh a lot, too. As a result, you're going to smile and catch more fish. Big ones, too. That's what makes me think you're going to enjoy Caught Me a Biggin, the way you'd enjoy actually fishing with me. That's a good way to approach this, like it's just the two of us out on a good lake, chunking and winding, with me telling a bunch of stories and pointing out ways to help you hook into some nice bass. And that's not a bad way to spend a day. Let's start with Jimmy Houston's number one rule of fishing. If it's important to a bass, I make it important to me. Fishing is all about learning and learning how to learn. The best fishermen, really the best people at anything, have learned how to see and watch. That's different than just looking. And the ability comes from training themselves how to study and think. It's also important to talk about your theories and techniques. When you and your buddies discuss what you've come up with, encourage them to look for loopholes and flaws in your reasoning. Sure, everyone likes to be told how smart they are, but we learn more from a kick in the seat of the pants than from a pat on the back. Starting from my early days on Lake Tenkiller, I always try to fish with lots of different folks whenever I have the chance. When you're out on the water with somebody you've never fished with before, pay attention to everything they're doing, especially what they're doing right. If it works for them, it'll work for you. I really can't remember a time I didn't fish. You can start when you're 3 or 4 years old the way I did, and you can fish till you're 100, and you'll still be learning on that last day you're out on the water. More to the point, you should still be learning, just like you should be learning every single other day you fish. The thing about this fishing game is you never know it all. Most people know more about fishing than they think they do, except for bass lovers who already think they know it all. We all have some knowledge, but often we don't use what we have. Sometimes we forget to think. When Saturday morning finally comes around and you get to your favorite lake, you're so darn happy to be there and to be fishing that you focus on the blue sky and the birds flying by and the fact that you're away from your daily routine and its problems. You focus on every single thing except the job at hand. What you're doing, and I like to say we've all been guilty of this, is putting your brain in neutral. And you don't have to be told that's not the most effective way to catch fish. When you think about the big four. I'm always talking about the four things to take into account whenever you're making your game plan for a day of fishing. I say it so often that my daughter Sherry could recite it in her sleep by the time she was 5. I'm just kidding. But certainly by the time she was 7. First, there's the time of the year. Fish behavior revolves around the seasons. Whether it's spawning in the spring, trying to keep cool during the summer, or feeding up during the fall in preparation for winter. Second is the type of water. By that I mean whether you're fishing a lake, a river, a stream, a pond, or another body of water. Third is water conditions. Is the water temperature rising or falling? Is the level rising or falling? Is the water clear or stained or murky? What's its pH level? Fourth is the matter of weather. Fish react to air temperature, wind, cloudy or clear sky, and especially to rising or falling barometric pressure. These four factors are so important that you should write them down on the top of your tackle box. That way, if your original game plan isn't working out, you won't waste time racking your brain about what you need to know for making revisions. The key thing about game plans is that they can always be refined or reworked. When one of those conditions change, so should your strategy. For example, suppose it's a real clear morning when you start out. You use a light-colored plastic worm and you're catching lots of biggins. But then a cloud cover rolls in. The fish stop biting. That's a signal to change your game plan. The first three factors, season, type of water, water conditions, haven't changed, but the weather has. The arrival of those big old clouds may call for a switch to a topwater bait, and when you do change over, you'll start catching fish again. That's called refinement, and it follows knowing how to approach each factor. Beginning with seasonal factors, let's look first at spring. Remember Jimmy Houston's number one rule? If it's important to a bass, I make it important to me. Well, bass reproduce only once a year, so you can bet that spawning is mighty important to them. Most fishermen divide the spawning season into three parts: pre-spawn, spawn, and post-spawn. However, I see it as four. There's also a pre-pre-spawn period when bass first move toward the water where they'll lay their eggs. Generally speaking, these are points of coves and pockets. I consider the pre-spawn area as the first 50% of the coves and pockets, about halfway in from the main point or the body of water. North banks are best because the surface water warms up quicker, and that's thanks to getting more sunshine than south banks do. Spinnerbaits, topwater baits, and jigs seem to work best, while deep-diving crawdad-colored crankbaits on light line are often a productive alternative. The spawning stage is when bass arrive into the spawning area. The magic water temperature that marks when they come with spawning on their mind is 58 degrees. The smaller males move onto the banks while the females stay in 4 to 7 feet of water. Because the ladies have major appetites before they spawn, you'll want to attract them with maximum size baits like a Magnum spinnerbait with a long trailer or a great big crankbait. Once the bass are on their spawning beds along the banks, try a gitset or a lizard or a minnow type of bait. Any fish caught on their spawning bed should always be released. If you don't, pretty soon that lake of yours won't have any fish to catch at any time. Of all four periods, the post-spawn period is the hardest to catch fish. After bass spawn, they move to where they suspend between 2 and 5 feet over deeper water. They often do their suspending amidst standing timber, and that's the first place I look. Edges of creek channels are other likely places, and so are the pre-spawn points of coves and pockets. During summertime, forget about the coves and the pockets and concentrate on the main body of the lake, especially those points that are close to main channels and creek channels. For good fishing on hot, humid summer days, try light tackle for panfish, a 5-foot limber rod with a small reel with 6-pound test with a 1/8 ounce or a 1/16 ounce chartreuse roadrunner at the end of it. Drop the bait down deep, then keep retrieving slowly. Hey, the fish will find you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.